a very merry, happy Easter to you and to yours. Thank you so much for joining us on Easter Sunday, or whenever you're watching this afterward at Surprise Church here in Bismarck, North Dakota. I'm especially excited for those of you who are watching from a long, long ways away, because we get to celebrate a global event in the resurrection of Jesus today. Thank you so much for joining us. We are going to be Easter Sunday at the Bell Mayhus Auditorium as a church, but we wanted to film a special message just for you, our online viewers, because when you're watching in the back of a crowd on the camera, it can feel a little bit less personal, but I wanted to just address you today. The message today is specifically for you, I'm going to tell you exactly why I say that today towards the end of the message, but this is a unique message that was in the making months ago in a way that's going to kind of surprise you. If you're a first-time viewer with us at Surprise, thank you for being here. We're so thrilled. Go ahead and follow this text prompt. Text the word CONNECT to 701-380-8210, okay? And then we will follow up with you. We have a gift that we'd like to send you in the mail for joining us. If you're a second-time viewer, this is your second round with us at Surprise, text RECONNECT to that number, and we will follow up with you as well. And we just love building our online audience. We have groups, virtual groups, in-person groups starting in different cities around the Midwest, and so we'd love you to just be in our extended family. And if we can support you in your faith or support your city in its spiritual walk with Christ and its impact, we'd love to. So thanks for connecting with us. Also, if you're willing, on Easter Sunday, let's do some good. Go ahead and check in at Surprise Church Bismarck's Facebook page. This month, every 6 check-ins provides a day of care to a child in need around the world. And you can use, if you want, hashtag compassion for kids. And there are thousands of churches doing this morning. And so we're going to provide a mountain of care for kids around the world in need through Compassion International. Thanks for your help checking in and doing good. Take a little selfie and post that with your check-in if you want to let people know. And then it'll be a good conversation starter with your friends who kind of are curious about what you're up to. So today we're starting a series called Raising the Dead. And guess what? Easter, it's not just for Jesus anymore. The resurrection is not just for Jesus. He is called the firstborn from the dead, which means that the resurrection story of Jesus is meant to unlock a sequence of hope and resurrection in your life and in mine, and not just after we die. Yes, when we die, God eventually will knock on your casket and wake you up and say it's time to go, or weave your ashes back into a human being that goes and spends eternity with God. But guess what? Resurrection happens every day as God brings healing, hope, and guidance to places where dead dreams, broken relationships, and pain have taken hold, and in a way that maybe you thought it was permanent. And God loves breaking into those situations just like he broke in and out of the empty tomb. So we're going to go there all month long. If you're going to continue with us, please do, because we'd like to show you what the resurrection means for you in everyday life. But today we're going to focus on that Easter message, because we want to lay that as a foundation of what God intends to happen in our lives. Sometimes, have you ever felt this way, that you're not supposed to bother Jesus? The disciples said this sometimes to people that were getting in line, especially kids. They got in line and she's like, don't bother the teacher. They shooed the kids away in a way that made Jesus upset. He got very upset at them, like, you don't know what you're talking about. Bring them to me. But sometimes we think maybe a problem is too big, or it's been going on long enough that I just shouldn't even bother God with it anymore. As if he's kind of a tired, just bordering on retirement kind of God, where he's kind of hanging up his God shoes and just getting ready to go to bed at night, and I just don't want to bother him. I'm not saying you've ever consciously thought that, but I think that can kind of take hold. I'm just not going to bother with it. I'm not going to get my hopes up. I'm not going to bother God with the same request, the same demand, the same need. There's a story in the Bible where this happened, and I want to show you Jesus' response to it. A woman who had been there, or was there, who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years, but no one could heal her. Honestly, after 12 years, kind of feels like a dead hope, right? Like that heart rate monitor, that EKG is kind of flatlined at this point. She's been bleeding. She's got a feminine bleeding problem that is not going away. She's slowly hemorrhaging. And in this culture, menstruation was sort of a sign of uncleanness, and women were really sectioned off in a way that certainly science has taught us differently today. And I'm glad we're not in the same place. But back then, this was a source of shame. This is a source of seen as unclean, outcast. And she was really a woman that was marginalized because of her medical issue. And so 12 years of that, don't bother Jesus. That's probably what she would have been told if she'd asked the disciples. It's probably what she'd have been told if she'd asked anybody that knows Jesus. Don't bother. I mean, 12 years, this thing isn't going anywhere. You're flatlined in your problem. Don't even hope for any sort of resurrection. Luke 8 goes on. She came up behind him and touched the edge of his cloak, and immediately her bleeding stopped. "Who touched me?" Jesus asked. "Someone touched me. I know that power has gone out from me." Then the woman, seeing that she could not go unnoticed, came trembling and fell at his feet. In the presence of all the people, she told him why she had touched him and how she had been instantly healed. Then he said to her, "Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace." I want you to bother me, in other words. This is not a bother to me at all. Don't be ashamed. Don't tremble. Don't feel guilty that you came to me for healing after all these years. I am here to heal. I am here to bring resurrection into your problems that seem like they are dead. And here to stay. It changed her life in an instant because she trusted that she wasn't bothering him. She was calling upon a God who was eager. So after 12 years of this medical issue, she was healed by Jesus, and the heartbeat of her joy and her life starts to beat once again. She experienced a version of resurrection in her life. Now, Jesus was on the way to visit a girl who was 12 years old. So this woman started bleeding 12 years ago in this city, and there's a girl born 12 years ago in this city. And Jesus was on his way to help this girl who was dying, this 12-year-old. But tragedy struck. Literally, her heart stopped beating. This little girl, daughter of Jairus, the synagogue leader, died. So again, do you bother Jesus now that she's dead? Well, no. They thought, you don't. While Jesus was still speaking, someone came from the house of Jairus, the synagogue leader. Your daughter is dead, Jairus, he said. Don't bother the teacher anymore. Don't bother Jesus. It's over. Don't bother Jesus. It's over. And I have to imagine that story. Jesus, the corner of his mouth, just tilted up just a little bit, like, ooh, this is going to be fun. Don't bother me, huh? Really? You don't want to bother me, huh? I can't deal with this. I'm too weak for this. It's too far gone. I can't handle it. A little beyond my pay grade. Is that kind of what you're saying? Is that kind of what you're thinking? Okay, let's see how this turns out. Let's just see how this sucker rolls. It's over, huh? Okay. Hearing this, Jesus said to Jairus, "Don't be afraid. Just believe and she will be healed." When he arrived at the house of Jairus, he did not let anyone go in with him except Peter, John, and James, and the child's father and mother. Meanwhile, all the people were wailing and mourning for her. "Stop wailing," Jesus said. "She is not dead, but asleep." Notice how he actually excludes people who don't believe that he can heal her and still believe that death is the final end of this story. He doesn't even let him in the room because it's so important sometimes to surround ourselves with people that actually believe in Jesus and what he can do. That even Jesus himself closed the door and says, "They can't come in. I'm not going to let them pull me down." You may have people in your life that you got to shut the door on, that don't believe in Jesus, that don't believe in who you can be in Christ, that just pull you down to their level rather than try to make you the best version of yourself. People can be unhealthy and have that effect on us. And I'm not saying you have to close the door on all your friends that aren't Christians or anything like that, but I am saying, do you have a circle of people that you can get together with like Jesus did here with these three and that really truly believe and cheer each other on? Very, very important. And we're going to give you a way to do that in the coming weeks at Surprise. And then when he tells them that they should stop crying, she's not dead but asleep, look what they do. They all laughed at him, knowing that she was dead. So Jesus is getting laughed at here. I mean, they were crying, but they took a break from their mourning to mock and laugh at Jesus because he believed that death wasn't the end of the story. Sometimes what we know is the problem, isn't it? Sometimes what we know about a person's past causes us to forget about who they can be in Christ in the future. Sometimes what we know about ourselves, our own limits, our own insecurities and failures, is the problem. Sometimes what we think we know about God or church or Christians is the problem. The certainty that we have accumulated calcifies into a rigid structure of false beliefs that leads a broken narrative to play out over and over and over and again. You know how people are kept in the sex trade? Tragically, they are told over and over again that this is the best you can do. No one else will take care of you. This is who you are. They just believe something that isn't true. Sometimes what we know is the problem when we're brainwashed or it's just programmed into us or where we just believe things about ourselves that aren't true. The devil can hold us in such a low status. Sometimes what we know is the problem. They laughed at him, knowing that she was dead. That's what they knew. But he took her by the hand and said, "My child, get up." Her spirit returned, and at once she stood up. Then Jesus told them to give her something to eat. Her parents were astonished, but he ordered them not to tell anyone what had happened. So here's the timeline. 12 years bleeding, healed by Jesus. 12-year-old, raised by Jesus. But here's the problem I want to put in front of us today. What happens when the dead raiser dies? What happens when the one himself is now hanging on a cross who used to raise others from the dead? What happens when that one dies? That was the great tragedy. People had seen Jesus raise the dead, and if it came to it, well, can Jesus heal another person and raise them from the dead? Sure, but he's dead now. Easter is the great answer to this question. What happens when the dead raiser dies? See, when they got to that tomb on Easter morning, the women got there first, and they were hoping that someone could get them in the tomb to bring spices and prepare Jesus' body for, you know, long-term entombment and internment. And the problem was, he wasn't there. When they showed up on Easter Sunday, it was empty. The tomb was vacant. Jesus had only used it temporarily. And now it would have to be returned to the owner. Jesus was a no-show at the Easter tomb for a very, very important reason. Look at this. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. It's scary. Even when, at this point, they were scared because they couldn't find him. They thought he'd been violated. They thought that he'd been stolen. They just wanted to have Jesus have a peaceful, serene place for his bones to rest. That was their best hope at the time. There was no resurrection hope here. It was just, let him rest in peace. Later, Jesus finds his followers and blows their minds. He opens their minds, it says. Then he opened their minds so that they could understand the scriptures. He told them, this is what was written. The Messiah must suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning in Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. Here's the deal. Jesus was a no-show in his tomb because, as that verse just said, he plans to show up everywhere else. First in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and then he says to the ends of the earth. He didn't show up in the empty tomb because he wants to show up in your life. He wants to live in your house. He wants to abide in your heart. Jesus didn't show up there so he could show up here with you, with me, with us every day in the good times and especially in those times where we need resurrection. He was a no-show because he wants to show up now. And if he stayed in the tomb, he wouldn't be here. You know where he showed up in my life last November? He showed up in the shower. And that's as X-rated as this sermon's going to get. I was taking a shower last November. I was using my 3-in-1 shampoo, 3-in-1, which is a great metaphor for the Trinity, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. I haven't used that in a sermon before, but it just occurs to me. You know, that's a side note. That's free. I'll add that in here. But I was sitting in the shower. I was using my 3-in-1 shampoo, and I was getting all puffy, you know, because you want to get the bubbles out there and, you know, get the big, you know, the shampoo afro, and I'm getting that going, and I'm scratching, and I had this vision, this image. Jesus showed up in the shower. He showed me this picture of an empty tomb. And I saw this whole Easter sermon being preached in my head. It was a weird vision moment. And I just stood there, bubbles and soap dripping down, getting in my eyes. But I wasn't looking through these eyes. I was just listening in my head. And it was a message about a God who said, I didn't show up there because I will show up here. I will show up everywhere else. And on Easter, I want you to tell these people that they're never going to be alone because I didn't show up there. I was a no-show there so I could be with them now everywhere. And I'm like, why? It's not even Christmas yet, Jesus. I don't even have my Christmas sermon done. So I emailed this to my team. I sent a long email of this sermon about God being a no-show in his tomb so we could show up everywhere else. And I emailed it, and they're like, we're still planning Christmas. I'm like, I know, but I don't want to forget this because Jesus just came into my shower, and he told me this, and this came into my head, and I got to write it down so I remember it. So the message, and this is what I was saying in the beginning, that you're hearing right now is a message that he showed up in an odd place to give me to give you. I know this message is for you today. And I know there's a part in your life where you believe is dead, is hopeless, is beyond God's reach, that you're almost tempted to say, well, I'm not going to bother Jesus with this, not with this one. And the corner of his mouth starts to come up and he smiles and says, oh, really? Is this over? Is the fat lady singing? I don't think so. The tomb was empty. I didn't show up there because I want to show up right there, right in that issue, right in that relationship, right in that financial issue, right in that health issue, right in that emotional issue that you don't think there's any hope for, that you don't think resurrection is possible. Let me show up there and show you what I can do. That's what we're going to be talking about this month. Dead dreams, dead relationships, dead hopes, dead opportunities that you thought are only in your past, but God has a bright future plan for you. Join us on April 11th as we return to Shiloh and dream about a God who raises the dead and imagine all the different ways that he can show up in the areas that we would be tempted to just say, don't bother Jesus. Jesus put everybody else outside the room when he went to heal that girl because you need sometimes just a room full of faith. And if you have never been in a surprise community group, either a virtual or an in-person community group, I want you to text groups to this number right now. We're going to help you get you wherever you are. If you're in Bismarck or if you're in Fargo or if you're in Nashville, Tennessee, we want to help you connect to a virtual or in-person group of people. They're going to help point you towards resurrection. They're going to help quiet the voices that laugh resurrection out of the picture, that don't believe it's possible, that know too much to be helpful, and that really point you in the right direction of the empty tomb in every area of your life. We'd like to help connect you to a group. So text groups to that number. We'll get you connected. And then in 2 weeks from today, we're going back to Shiloh from the Bell Mayhews Auditorium. And then in 2 weeks, we're going to be at home. We're not doing Sunday church at all. We're instead going to be doing church in your living room, literally, not just on your screen, but in your living room or in a friend's living room. So if you visit this site, this webpage that you see on the screen, you'll see some directions for how you can do church at home for Sunday. We're hoping to have twice as many people doing church than normal because people are inviting their neighbors, coworkers, family, and friends. Maybe even people they live with that don't go to church will show up for this one because they have no choice. So I promise you, if you open up your front door in a new way, to share a meal with people, watch a video we'll create, and then just talk about it real simple but effective and powerful, it could lead to some things that you didn't thought possible. You didn't even dream could happen, where your home becomes a vibrating, pulsating, empty tomb, resurrection, enforcing, joy-creating force in your neighborhood and in the spheres of influence that God has given you. He's going to show up in your house on April 18th, I believe it, and the days that follow. So stop by that webpage. Let us know on the email address on the page that you're interested, and we'll give you some resources and some tips for how to do that really, really well. And in closing, I just want to invite you to remember something. When it comes to these areas of your life where you don't think resurrection is possible, save your receipt. Save it. You're going to need it. See, Jesus either bought or had somebody bought and gave him a tomb. And that usually tombs don't get returned. Tombs are not temporary. Tombs are permanent residences for dead people. But I sure hope they saved the receipt for Jesus' tomb because they gave it back. Can you imagine the owner's face when they came back on Monday morning? Like, yeah, I didn't have a receipt, but can I have my money back? Why? We don't need that tomb anymore. What? Yeah, we only needed it for the weekend. We're good now. He's back. Who's back? Jesus. Who's Jesus? The dead guy. The dead guy? Yeah. Don't need the tomb anymore. But like I said before, that's not just Jesus' story, it's yours. Save the receipt in the relationship you think is broken and hopeless, in the emotional struggles that you think are permanent, in the loneliness you feel and the isolation you've felt over the last year, the feeling of dread you may have for the future or guilt you may have for the past. Save your receipt, because since resurrection is possible, you're going to give that back. And you're not going to need that tomb anymore. You're not going to need that place where you thought it was permanent. Save your receipt. Just like Jesus gave the tomb back, he's going to bring resurrection into every area of your life that you invite him to live. So save your receipt. Good Friday and Easter Sunday mean that the travails in your life are temporary and that hope is eternal. Thank you for joining us this Easter. God bless you. Can't wait to see you online and in person next Sunday and then for church at home in 2 weeks. God bless you guys. Happy Easter.